Hey, Chuck. How about a little service down here? That's if Mr. Frazzlebottom or whatever his name is don't object.
Eddie don't mean no real harm, Mr. Ringo.
Then let Eddie keep his big ugly nose out of my business.
Anything I can do for you? What a ridiculous statement.
The men are following me.
Really? I can't understand why.
As time goes by.
Sam, I thought I told you never to play.
If you had the choice, which of those movie roles would you like to play? The gangster, gunfighter, song and dance man, lover, if that's your inclination? Well, recently I had something like this opportunity. My name is George Plimpton, and my particular device as a reporter is to enter various exotic professions as an amateur, hoping by actual participation to sharpen my impressions. I've done this a number of times in the world of football, training with the Detroit Lions as their last string quarterback, boxing, stumbling through three nerve-wracking rounds with light heavyweight champion Archie Moore, music, a few years ago with considerable anguish, hitting some percussion instruments for the New York Philharmonic. Now I've had a chance at filmmaking, and of the possibilities, I found myself a bit part in a big-budget Western. In this case, fortunately, I was in the hands of one of the world's great directors, Howard Hawks, and this fella, John Wayne, the star. Now, the story calls for a showdown between the two of us in the Rio Lobo Saloon. Now, why don't you join us and see what happens? Author of Paper Lion, Skies In From the East, as they would put it in the movie trade journals, to Tucson, Arizona, where the film crew of Rio Lobo had been shooting for about 3 weeks. An assistant director remarked on a week's growth of beard I had cultivated, actually the only preparation demanded of me, so far. My part in Rio Lobo was pretty far down in the credits. I was told on the ride out through the pipe cactus country that I was one of a gang of four who rides into town in the first reel and has a shootout with John Wayne in a saloon. The company was on location in old Tucson, a replica of a cow town which pulls in as many tourists as movie people. Howard Hawks was in there, expecting me for a screen test in full Badman regalia.
This is fine. How many times do you reckon this shirt has been worn in the motion pictures?
Good Lord, I'd say 200-300 times, possibly.
200-300 times?
You can usually tell whether a boot fits or not by the noise it makes when your foot finally slips in.
Not the screams of the guy wearing it?
No.
Didn't. In this case, I think Gary Cooper must have worn him.
No kidding.
Really?
Ah, the best. This belonged to anybody?
Jimmy Stewart.
I don't believe it.
Really?
There, how's that?
Looks pretty good, George.
Feels all right?
Looks good. You better get over to makeup.
Where's that?
In the church.
Yeah, that looks... Oh, it's sort of a modified handlebar. But I don't know. That kind of makes you look like an organ driver.
Yeah, I might agree. Off she comes.
And that gives us the heavy as we go. You see what that does for you now?
Yeah, but I can feel it.
Let's just take this off and see how that looks,
Well...
What do you think now?
Meaner.
You're playing a bad, bad deputy sheriff working for a bad guy.
Well, I've heard of some of those bad deputy sheriffs.
Well, watch out for Whitey. He's the one to watch out for.
Is he the leader?
Yeah, he's the leader.
Right, Ray. Which way is that again?
Right over here.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
All right.
I didn't feel particularly mean or at home in that cowboy outfit. The the James Stewart vest and the Gary Cooper chaps, if that's what they really were. And my confidence wasn't helped by losing my way.
Excuse me, you know where the set is, where they're shooting? Have any idea at all? Not well. Thank you.
I felt just as lost and out of place wandering through old Tucson as I'd felt in the early days of the Detroit Lions camp. And then there it was, the Cowtown street full of equipment and technicians, and I knew that somewhere in there Mr. Hawks was waiting to see what he let himself in for.
Excuse me, George Plimpton. I'm joining your company, I believe, as the second heavy.
Duke, George Plimpton.
Hello, how are you?
He's going to play Paper Tiger?
Paper Lion.
Paper Lion, yeah.
He's going to get shot in the saloon.
Oh.
George, it's real,
just supposed to be a little test. If you'll get out there, well, we'll go right at it. More for makeup or something like that. Okay, roll them whenever you get ready.
Not nervous, are you?
All right, George, now just looking about.
Don't look in that little eye unless you're giving him a sermon from the mount.
Good, that's fine. Just hold it a minute. Try the other side.
It's like a mugshot here.
Yeah. All right, now try a little dialogue here. There's a line, George.
Is this the line I'm actually going to say?
This is the line you're going to say, yeah.
Near the camera so I can get your eye.
This here's your warrant, mister.
It's a good-looking hat. Where'd you get it?
Props.
Is that props?
It's not my own.
Usually wardrobe.
Wardrobe, that's the word, yeah, wardrobe.
George, where'd you go to school?
I went to Harvard, George.
Well, there's a little accent creeping into that. Well, see if you can hear it, Duke.
This here's your warrant, mister.
Trolley.
Slower.
Trolley, yeah.
This here's your warrant, mister.
That's a lot better. You just work on that a little bit. Well, George, there you see yourself.
Shattering sight.
There's only one thing that really goes wrong, and that's the accent that you have. I can still hear Harvard in there. And that isn't too good for a Western. I'd hate to have to give this line to somebody else. I'd much rather that you do it.
So go to work.
I will. I want that line.
This here's your warrant. This here's your warrant, mister. This here's your warrant, mister. So there I was with my one line. Mr. Hawks advised seeing the company dialogue coach, Danny Sands. The first indication, it turned out, of Mr. Hawks' somewhat droll sense of humor.
This here's your warrant, mister.
That's the way you'd say it.
That's the way I'd say it. But I don't know why he would send you to me.
Why is that?
I'm the worst person in the world. I can't say the lines myself.
Is he giving you lines for films?
In each film. Makes me sick for weeks. And Red River for 3 weeks. To carry a little load of wood in and say, this be all, ma'am, to Joe Andrew.
Yeah.
For 3 weeks, I wanted to play my part. And for 3 weeks, I throw it up every day.
I don't believe it.
I do.
You got a line in this picture?
Yes.
What's
maybe
that?
20 takes.
20 takes?
Hey, you in the jail.
Take 15.
Speed.
Hey, you in the jail.
What do you want?
I got a message for you, but I don't want to get killed. Bring it to...
Oh.
Take 16.
Hey, you in the jail.
Yeah, what do you want?
I got a message for you, but I don't want to get shot. Bring it to you.
Take 17.
Hey, you in jail.
Yeah, what do you want?
Jail. Hey, you in the jail. Still rolling, all right?
Hey, you in the jail.
Yeah, what do you want?
I got a message for you, but I don't want to get shot, killed.
Save it.
What do you do, Danny, when you're not learning these lines that make you sick?
Well, then I rear in my horses, fall my horses.
And that doesn't give you any trouble at all?
Never no trouble.
No sense of being shy on camera when you're on a horse?
No, I doubled Cantiflis in 80 Days Around the World. I doubled Bergman and Joan of Arc. 30-some-odd years falling on my head.
How did you double Bergman and Joan of Arc?
So Danny Sands turned out not to be a dialogue coach, but a stuntman. Nonetheless, I'd met an important figure in the making of motion pictures, quite unique to films, even if their contribution, as in the case of Danny Sands as Ingrid Bergman, is often very brief. There it is,
The range of daring feats required of these men in the name of entertainment is amazing. And the stuntmen on the Rio Lobo set spoke of their colleagues' more spectacular achievements with just the same sense of pride that actors or directors find to praise those of their own fraternity. As far as I knew, my own role in Rio Lobo didn't call for any extravagant physical acts of this sort. But in my preparation, they were always the basics. I could start with my walk and try to establish something like the traditional effect of the gunman walking down that familiar, deserted, sun-baked street. Of course, there were famous models to go by, perhaps the most well-known, the world-weary, oddly awkward gait of Gary Cooper, or the slower, more arrogant version of Robert Mitchum's, or Randolph Scott, quicker, confident, aristocratic, or the infinitely slow, cautious approach of Henry Fonda, and of course, the master himself.
I want to get a lesson on the proper walk, Duke.
Well, the walk's been kind of a secret in our family for a long time. My dad taught me, but I can't keep it forever. I'll tell you how he showed me.
There is a trick to it, is there?
Yeah, he says, you pick up one foot, put it forward and set it down, then you pick up the other foot, set it down, and that's walking forward. If you do the reverse, you're walking back.
No, I'm thinking too hard about walking.
Well, that looks like a nice, easy walk. I don't think you'll get any disc problems with that one. But to look like you're in complete control, the best thing is to have your... to be walking on the flat of your foot or the balls of your feet.
Yeah, yeah.
That's all I can give you.
Well, that's a good lesson.
Okay.
From walking to riding, since I was going to have to ride into town with my fellow killers, and here I had the help of Dean Smith, an actor and a champion trick rider.
Like this.
He tried to show me how to mount a horse in one fluid motion. There's a trick to it. You have to hit the stirrup just right in your jump. It looks easy, but it isn't, particularly under the hard gaze of Mr. Wayne.
Well, that's easy, but I just can't do it in one motion.
You like that? Let's get out of here. Come on.
And then the shooting irons, without which the Western wouldn't exist.
You know, there are only two things more beautiful than a good gun. Swiss watch or a woman from anywhere. You ever had a good Swiss watch?
Go ahead, try it.
Well, George, I don't know whether I should...
Dean Smith and Mike Henry, one of the film's bad men, helped me on gun handling so I'd be ready to put on a good show against Mr. Wayne in the saloon.
You know something? I see some tin cans over. I think I'll show you some stuff with live ammunition.
Well, I don't know whether you want Coca-Cola or Budweiser, but we'll try Coca-Cola first.
I bet you a steak dinner you can. Yeah.
What's the secret, Mr. Senator, before you do it? Is it you going to sight name or is it just off the hip?
Well, I think I'll just sight name. Like this one.
Oh.
Gee, I just don't believe it.
Let's see how you can do it.
Well, I'll try, but I'm not going to do for any old steak dinner because I just can't shoot that well.
Well, go ahead and try it.
I'll give it a try. Oh. Gotta do that. Well, holy smoke, look at that.
Right, George.
Well, you're pretty good.
Well, I should have bet the dinner. I believe it.
See what else you can do then. Come on now.
Mr. Wayne better look out. Look at that.
Hey, Dean, that's all I have.
Another put-on. In film, bullet hits to bomb blasts are controlled by this box and its master, A.D. Flowers. He told me that actually the most difficult special effects task of his career was in a Gene Kelly musical, making a ball bounce down steps to three-quarter time.
All right, Tim.
Colonel, you got more help than you think. There's men over there behind.
wasn't learning what I could for my part, thinking about my big line from time to time. It was a matter of standing around and taking notes, watching, dazzled really by the complication of the operation, and in wonderment that any order could come of it.
399, take one.
Blighty, watch yourself. There's a pack of them. You ready to shoot?
Got it.
Pimpleton, will you get the hell out of there? And stay out.
With my scene coming up soon, I began to have the jitters about embarrassing myself before the camera. It's a common fear, and often there are grounds for it, as Victor French, who plays the lead heavy, remembered about his start.
My most embarrassing experience happened in the first Western I ever did. My father was in Western Pictures. He started in 1916. And so I played cowboys all my life, you know, with the toy guns and everything. Yeah. And on my first day in a picture, one day bit, you know, on an old Ziv Western, and all I had to do was walk out into the street and meet the leading character at a showdown, right? So I knew how to draw a gun because I'd drawn all these toy guns all my life. You know? So what did I do? I whipped out this gun and went with my mouth. And the director came over calmly. The crew was in hysterics and said, we really have developed facilities now to make that sound. One way is really pulling the trigger on the pistol, you see, loading it with blanks and the like. The great old Western bit, though, is the guy who draws.
As for Mr. Wayne, he was never one to be flustered by the mechanics of movie acting. Discovered in the prop department, he stepped before one of the original sound cameras over 40 years ago, prepared just as I had been by being sent to a dialogue coach.
There was one of these dialogue directors that had been sent out, and he said, you go to him twice a week. There's a line in the picture where this fella can't go on with a train, and he's been with it for 6 months going across the desert, and in the distance is the Great White Mountain, and he's supposed to, with sentiment, say, well, Zach, when you get there, tell the Great White Mountain hello for me. But this guy was using the cape in every line, and he had me out saying, tell the Great White Mountain hello for me. And so after Walsh found that out, he gave me the test and finally the part.
You string along behind them, and if they make it through, you'll find your valley. And tell that Great White Mountain hello for me. Goodbye, Zeke.
The picture was called The Big Trail, a big-budget Western, which turned out to be such a box office bust that Wayne, just as abruptly as he'd been raised from prop boy to leading man, was flung from stardom into an odd sort of limbo. He was forced to act bit parts for the major studios, often weak, unglamorous roles. He supported such established stars as Douglas Fairbanks, Jr., in The Life of Jimmy Dolan.
He's all right, busted up a little inside.
That's what he gets for coming in.
Come on, let's go.
Not you. He wants Smith next.
Who, me?
Trying to get my goat, huh?
All set? Well, I've only got one hand bandage.
We'll bandage the other one in the ring.
Well, Doggett, you're all ready, aren't you?
Ain't turning chicken, are you?
I'll box his ears off.
His ears is upstairs. Come on.
The role was so small that he got knocked out off screen. Yet he continued to play the hero in countless B-Westerns like this rather remarkable film.
Up your guns, outlaw, and cinch them on tight. There'll be blood a-running in town before night. There'll be guns a-blazing, singing with
light. Why, that's singing Sandy.
Tonight you'll be drinking.
Who? Your the most notorious gunman since Billy the Kid.
The dead.
Make it fast, Slippery. This is your last draw.
Jimmy. All through the early 30s, the major studio showed about as much interest in John Wayne as Barbara Stanwyck did in Babyface.
Oh,
I never see you anymore.
I never see anybody anymore. I'm working so hard.
Gee, but
I'm sorry. I have to go to bed early every night. Excuse me, will you?
Then in 1939, 10 years after The Big Trail, director John Ford picked Wayne for Stagecoach, a film which became a great critical and commercial success, and it renewed the public interest in the epic Western.
Hello, kid.
Hello, Curly.
I'll take the Winchester.
You may need me in this Winchester, Curly. Saw a ranch house burning last night.
In Stagecoach, Wayne's characterization of the heroic was fully developed, and it went with him, traveling very easily from the far west to the wartime skies of World War II, as he continued to prevail over the forces of evil. Only very rarely does the John Wayne hero lose out. It took the Japanese army to finally get him, fighting sea bees, and as one would imagine, when John Wayne goes, he goes big.
Mr. Dunson, I'll say it just one more time.
By 1948, he had come a long way as an actor. Working under the direction of Howard Hawks for the first time in another Western classic, Red River, he could play a many-dimensional and often unsympathetic role with complete conviction.
You're soft. You yellow belly. Whatever.
Soon after Red River, in John Ford's The Quiet Man, Wayne attempted another complex part, which required both humor and gentleness.
Old one you are.
The film received 7 Academy Award nominations, yet none, ironically, for Wayne. His colleagues simply weren't prepared to acknowledge that an action star could also be a sensitive performer as well.
Well, some things a man doesn't get over so easy.
Like what, supposing?
Like the sight of a girl coming through the fields with the sun on her hair, kneeling in church with a face like a saint.
Saint indeed.
And now coming to a man's house to clean it for him.
But that was just my way of being a good Christian act.
I know it was, Mary Kate Danaher. And it was nice of you.
Not at all.
It wasn't until 1970, 4 decades after he started, that John Wayne received his first Oscar for the film True Grit. The award was not only for this picture, perhaps, but for a retrospective of Wayne films, over 200 of them.
Captain, hold it right where you are.
On location with Rio Lobo, one was always aware of the physical presence of the Duke, towering over everyone, a voice that one hears booming across the lot, a big, open, robust laugh. What impressed me was that he was always on the set, even when it wasn't his scene. And there wasn't anything that went on he didn't take an active interest in. The word his friends all used for him was professional. As for myself, I was a bit uneasy around him. I went through quite a lot of joshing and his getting my name wrong. And I think the reason was that he's such a professional that a dude hanging around, this Easterner in a cowboy outfit, sort of cluttered up the scenery in his eyes. But above all else, he had the film's interest in mind, and he helped me when he could.
No, I think the most important thing in pictures, a line particularly where you're saying, I have a warrant for you, well, just make damn sure you keep looking at his eyes. You know, if you go in and say, I got a warrant for you, you know, there's not much strength to it. But if you look him in the eye...
That's a good tip.
He'll check the warrant.
Yeah. It's good.
The ingenue in Rio Lobo was a New York model, just starting off in films, Jennifer O'Neill, who was an eager recipient of advice, just as I was, particularly from Howard Hawks.
But I must say, he did one funny thing. When I was speaking with him, he was telling me how to get my voice lower. And not knowing Mr. Hawks too well, I didn't know quite what he was up to, and he told me to come over, and he punched me in the stomach, kept pressing my stomach, and said, count 1, 2, 3, 4. And for a while, I was wondering what was going on, but he was telling me how to get the voice down.
Is it going down?
I'm working on it.
Sounds like a pretty rough way of getting your voice down, to be punched in the belly.
Yeah, my poor tummy.
Mr. Hawks has put many an ingenue through her paces since he began directing in the silent days. I never could get enough watching him at work. As a writer, I've always been fascinated by the creative act. In motion pictures, the original mental image must be filtered down through machines and men, not to forget studio chiefs, which struck me as making it an impossibly frustrating form. Moreover, Hawks doesn't stick to the original script. He changes it every morning on a yellow pad to make it fit the flow of shooting, often rewriting the dialogue of some very illustrious writers, William Faulkner, among others. I also asked him about Hemingway.
Ernest always said that he was good in his own line. He was a little afraid to come out to Hollywood. And I said, well, we can take your worst story and make a picture out of it. And he, rather grumpily, said, what was my worst story? And I said, to have and to have not, which was a bunch of junk. Well, he said, I needed some money. And I said, well, we can make it. He said, you can't make a picture out of that. And I said, sure. And I bought it, and we made a picture. When I told Ernest how much money it made, he didn't talk to me for 4 or 5 months.
Hawks told me that his major aim during the making of a film was to achieve 3 strong scenes and hope the rest of the time not to offend the audience. One such scene was in To Have and To Have Not, the meeting between Bogart and Bacall, and it was supported by lines off that yellow pad, which became some of the most famous in motion pictures.
You don't have to say anything and you don't have to do anything. Not a thing. Oh, maybe just whistle. You know how to whistle, don't you, Steve? You just put your lips together and blow.
Not only memorable lines did Hawks give us, but as in Red River, a stirring orchestration of visual movement and space. And then there were the Hawks' innovations, such as the overlapping dialogue sequences of His Girl Friday, utterly new for its time.
Will you do me a favor, Bruce, please?
I just wanted to ask you one question. You don't want to come with me.
I need that.
Come on. You don't, do you?
No. Take all those Miss America pictures off, face sake.
Hildy, tell me.
Oh, well.
You ever loved me, Hildy?
Now, look here, my good man.
You shut up, Byrne.
No, how can I do anything?
You're doing all this to her. I know that. She wanted to get away from you.
Take Hitler and stick him on the funny page.
I don't know yet what I'm going to tell him. It'll be pretty close to the truth.
And yet, finally, the characterizations that Hawks molded of what one remembers, such as the strength of Bogart and Bacall here in The Big Sleep, somehow insolence playing off insolence, so that one was left with great romance.
You've forgotten one thing. Me.
What's wrong with you?
Nothing you can't fix.
Now, you carry so much of the film in your head. Does it ever take violent shifts and turns over from one departures from the original script due to...
Oh, sure. You find some actor is working out very, very well, and you change a scene so that he can do more. You find he's doing certain things well. You're inclined to give him more of that type of thing to do.
Have you ever... killed off a character that you didn't think was living up to your expectations just to get rid of him?
Oh, yes.
Well, perhaps I'm in that category.
Well,
boy, that sent me scurrying off to try my line.
I believe I'd say it. This here's your warrant, mister.
I say, this here's your warrant, mister.
How's that?
I think that's about the way I said it.
Sure.
Yeah.
This here's your warrant, mister.
The line wasn't quite, when you want me, just whistle, but it was my own.
Here's your warrant, mister. There she goes. You know, there's really not much else to do on a movie set when you're waiting for your big scene, except practice the gunplay and the line. This here's your warrant, mister. In fact, you think about that line so much that it becomes absolutely meaningless, like saying hippopotamus 1,000 times. This is typical. This is waiting for a shot to be prepared. Mr. Hawk's practicing his golf, and over in the distance, the actors are playing liar's poker. What's really amazing about this waiting is that these actors, when Mr. Hawk says camera, that they're going to be able to bring a freshness to their lines, even if they've waited around for 3 or 4 days. And that's what I find awkward in my own case. My one line is no longer fresh, and the idea of saying it in a fresh manner, I find extremely difficult to imagine.
I found that often the spark that ignites an actor into a fine performance comes when he shares the scene with another skilled player, each benefiting by playing off the other. In this case, John Wayne and Jack Elam, who was one of motion pictures' fine character actors.
You said you were a saintly old man that didn't hold with all the vices.
I don't hold with them at all. But they don't stop me from taking a saintly pleasure in them whenever I get a chance.
Jack Elam has a wayward, squinty eye that gets him countless villain roles, but here he plays John Wayne's sidekick. Walking along with Dave Huddleston, a fellow character actor, the two got talking about the tricks of their trade.
If you don't like what they see you as, how do you get out of that?
Well, luck. You have to get lucky. I mean, I've been lucky lately. I, you know, you wear a beard in one, I got a beard in this. It's a dirty old man. I'm playing a guy, 75 or 80? And the last one, I was a young guy.
Uh-huh.
But you've moved, haven't you, from the great heavy of all time now to a good guy. Is that an easy transformation to make?
It's the same thing. I read the same things the same way. It's just what somebody else says you are, you know? Yeah. There's nothing in your own personal preparation is any different at all. It's the lines they give you to say. You're saying good lines instead of bad lines, or I'm standing alongside the sheriff instead of alongside some outlaws.
You were talking about the character actors I'd worked with, Pemberton. I was...
wonder if we're going to get that...
A little short. What is...
Well, in case you ever refer to me as one of the great character actors you worked with, it'd be terrible if we didn't get the name right.
Yeah, let's see. What is there? Honestly. Plimpton, author of Paper Tiger.
Paper right. Lion. We'll get it straight.
Oh, Paper Lion. Okay. I'm awfully sorry.
It's all right.
Well, anyway, I worked with fellas like Thomas Mitchell and McLaglen, little Barry Fitzgerald, Donald Meek. Just wonderful fellas.
Hi.
Did I say Mitchell? Thomas Mitchell?
Yeah. Being so partial to the weed myself, I sometimes forget that it disagrees with others.
When one looks into it, the character actor often carries the entire scene.
Gentleman doesn't smoke in the presence of a lady.
3 weeks ago, I took a bullet out of a man who was shot by a gentleman. The bullet was in his back.
You mean to insinuate...
Sit down, mister. How do you know the water's good?
I let it patrol that way.
Well, what do you think it's worth... You think it's worth...
What are you mumbling about?
The best of the character actors can steal the scene, intimidating the star, perhaps, but... Delighting astute directors like Howard Hawks, who often use the talents of a Walter Brennan, with or without teeth.
Not like rubbing the trip all that way. You heard me good that time, didn't you? Well, I might be able to persuade him. It might be just the time of year when old Cookie like a change of scenery could be persuaded. It might be they're already persuaded because he happened to quit this morning.
I should remember to pay it.
The faces and voices of character actors are as familiar as those of leading men, though top billing is seldom their reward.
Certainly.
We'll give a man a hand, then.
Saddle his horse.
Why doesn't somebody do something?
Perhaps there are compensations that the character actors can find more challenge with their roles. They can enjoy more flexibility than the type star.
Today was like a nightmare to me.
And then those actors who perfect a unique character which they take from picture to picture. Elijah Cook Jr.'s Frightened Ferret. Cuddles Accall's Lovable Viennese and Florence Bates's Town Nag. Misha Auer's Mad Russian Rolls.
All I want to do is to guard the East Gate.
Grady Sutton's Prissy Weakling.
Your precious Arab steed and that wolfhound dear to your heart.
Sig Ruman's Popeye Hysteric. John Quaylen's Persecuted Milk Toast. Porter Hall, Always Foreclosing the Mortgage. Frank McHugh's Happy Irishman and the man who rarely drew a sober breath, Jack Norton. The roster of splendid characterizations is endless, yet these actors, to whom recognition is so important, must also face the uncertainties of a tenuous occupation.
You know the story about the five stages of an actor's life?
Yes.
Yes.
First stage is, who is Jack Elam? Second stage is, get me Jack Elam. Third stage is, get me a Jack Elam type. Fourth stage is, get me a young Jack Elam. Fifth stage is, who is Jack Elam?
That is beautiful. Now, you got something to say about Huddleston?
No, I just keep using my name.
As for making a name for oneself, over in the next valley in a motorcycle film, a distinguished name in one profession, Joe Namath, is working at establishing himself in another, in acting, perhaps a more unpredictable arena than the football stadium.
Learning the lines isn't difficult, but speaking them comfortably, you know, and just trying to be natural is a problem now and then. I still can't get myself to react to someone saying something. You know the camera's on you and everybody's looking at you and someone off screen says something, you have to react with a smile. And I find that difficult to do.
You like just drifting around?
I think looking is a better word.
For what?
If I knew that, I wouldn't be looking now, would I?
What do you find the toughest part of it so far?
Waiting around, I guess, and getting up early in the morning. I'm not too used to hell. I'm getting up today about the time I usually get in Miami or New York. It's ridiculous, man. But I have learned one thing about this profession, man. I really learned to respect and admire the fellas that do this for a living.
Well, back to your choppers and all. I gotta get back
to my
horses.
Yeah, you gotta get back to your horses, right?
My final piece of preparation was the morbid business of my death. Mr. Hawks told me that if I could come up with a novel way of dying, he'd use it. So I had some film sent down of practitioners of this fine art, which consists largely of keeping to one's feet as long as possible to stretch out the scene. That's Bob Steele hanging on in The Big Sleep.
That's one, Eddie.
John Ridgely got a fine opportunity to milk his demise.
Don't shoot, it's me, Mark!
Hello, put that phone down.
Once again, Bogey, as the universal dispatcher, and his tenacious victim, Conrad Veidt. But it was Tom Tyler at the hand of Errol Flynn who was champ of them all in terms of prolonging the inevitable.
What's the matter, Leif? Something go wrong?
I hoped my dispatcher, the Duke, would cooperate with me. Perhaps a shot or two first in the kneecap so I could stagger around a bit. This was it, my first time before the camera, riding into town for my big line in the saloon. I was never able to get the plot of Rio Lobo straight. I was never shown a script, and besides, everything was usually changed on Mr. Hawks's yellow pad. I gathered we were to abduct the ingenue who was inside the hotel seeking help from the local sheriff.
All right, Cam.
Nobody in the jail, Whitey.
All right.
George, go around back. Come in that way. door.
Stay. All right, Campbell.
What we didn't know was that the local sheriff had a friend in there with him. The Duke.
Pat.
Well, young lady, you gave us quite a chase.
Sheriff, this is the man that I wanted you to arrest. He's the murderer.
Who are you, mister? And what exactly is your business here?
Name's Carter. Whitey Carter. I'm a deputy from Rio Lobo. As to my business, I came looking for her. She's wanted.
What for?
She and the old man she lived with ran one of them medicine shows. Sheriff in Rio Lobo wants to talk to her. So we'll just take her along with us.
Just a minute, Mr. Carter. I'm the sheriff of Blackthorn, and I'd like to see a warrant.
Warrant?
For this young lady's arrest.
Well, you know, I never thought about that.
Without a warrant, you're not taking anyone.
This here is your warrant, mister.
George Plimpton, on the set.
It was an odd sensation, after being so much on the periphery as an observer, suddenly to have the attention of everyone focus on me and that one deadly line. Now I was the object they were going to have to manipulate through the scene. It was all suddenly so serious, this, and professional.
George, come in. Use your way.
We'll just walk in slow.
All right, folks, quiet down.
Here's your warrant. Quiet for rehearsal.
You know, I never thought about that.
Mr. Carter, without a warrant, you're not taking anyone.
This here's your warrant, mister.
Satisfied, Sheriff?
All right. Good.
Can he aim the gun at these men here?
He better.
You better aim right at the...
Yes, sir?
Over that way.
If you don't take it, it won't look like anything. You're going to have to pop your head. Not your body, but your head.
Yeah. Slowly, the indignities I was going to go through as the second heavy began to unfold. The first being a belt in the jaw from my own gun.
It won't hit you.
No, and don't walk
in. I'm not scared about being hit.
While the final details are being worked out on the set, I was sent to a corner to practice.
Well, I just took it out of from underneath. Really farther away from that.
Yeah. Right. Wow. See. Got you.
All right, everybody. This is a rehearsal.
Without a warrant, you're not taking any.
This here's your warrant, mister.
Satisfied, Sheriff?
All right. Now, wait just a second. George, keep that gun right where you're looking. Right over there. It was pointing up a little bit. You see what I mean?
If you practice cocking it when you say it, it'd be better.
Okay, you want me to cock it as I say this here?
Well, you'd come in with it cocked. I mean, if you're going to use this gun, you'd have it like that. I can put it on my hip and aim it right at him and have that.
So I don't cock it.
If you come like that, you're not ready to shoot me. You know, guys that have handled these lever actions and say...
Oh, Jordy, you change that line. Just say, I got a warrant right here, Sheriff.
You want me to change the line? I've been working on it for a week. It's going to take quite a time.
Oh, you can do it, Mr. Plankton.
Shot my confidence here. I got a warrant right here, Sheriff. I got a warrant right here, Sheriff.
Wasn't it right here I got a warrant, Sheriff? No. How was it?
I may use this a little closer.
He may load it.
All right, Cam.
Warrant. For the young lady's arrest.
You know, I never thought about that.
Mr. Carter, without a warrant, you're not taking anyone.
I got a warrant right here, Sheriff.
Satisfied, Sheriff? Now drop your gun and go sit down.
What we killers didn't know was that Jennifer had a derringer under the table.
Roll them for a wild track.
My one line delivered, I had to duplicate the grunts as if I really had been popped by the Duke.
Try two, three different ways.
Spade!
All right, Captain. Good, okay, fine.
Great.
Of course, I still had to be killed. That would happen after lunch.
Oh, you're great. You got the bar. Get the bar. You get the bar. That's great, because it's just the right height. You get shot, and then you can kind of go down, because the bar is always round. You don't get splinters on it going down.
And always keep your eyes open.
Eyes open?
Yeah, eyes open. I think that's a good touch. Just kind of stare.
They let them come over, and they have to close them.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. That always makes a good touch. And then you just stop breathing, you know.
While makeup was creating the effect of being smashed by Mr. Wayne, I found out from a script girl that my part now called for me to pull myself up and try to shoot the Duke in the back with a pistol. Then I get shot. A.D. Flowers rigged a harness which, pulled violently by wires, would slam me flat up against the wall in simulation of being blasted with a rifle. It wouldn't be the Duke shooting me, it turned out, but some other fella. Still, I assumed I would have the chance to play the death scene to the hilt, stuck flat against the wall, giving them the glazed look, and then slowly, infinitely slowly, beginning to slide down.
Now!
The final indignities ricocheted into a corner with not the slightest chance of my big scene, and moreover, shot down by a guy in pink tights I'd never seen before. Put together, it seemed hard to believe that this brief sequence had utilized the energy and imagination of over 100 people for 2 days.
I got a warrant right here, Sheriff.
Satisfied, Sheriff? Now drop your gun and go sit down. All right, everyone stand still. No one gets hurt. Come on, you.
Well, George, that's your last shot.
You've done a good job.
I'll never forgive you for changing my mind over there. Brutal blow.
Oh, it's been wonderful co-starring with you.
Duke, you didn't give me much of a chance at you there.
No, Jesus.
One great rifle in the chin, that's the only time I ever saw you. You better look out in your next picture. I'll be back.
Come on,
Well, we'll be happy about it if you do.
Great.
You've taken a lot of kidding on this. And you're taking it well. We're very happy to have had you aboard.
Well, it's great fun to be on board. It really was.
Good.
Well,
thank
good
you, George.
Good luck with the rest of it.
Thank you again.
The prop men seemed awfully anxious to relieve me of the shooting iron, which had failed me so abysmally against the Duke.
George, doesn't this give you a feeling that you are a finished actor?
In more ways than one. I think one is always a little sad leaving the props of illusion, the pistol that shoots blanks, the whiskey that is, of course, tea, shaving off the beard and getting out of the cowboy costume. Actors speak of this, that it is good to be someone else for a while, to escape into a different world, even if it is one of illusion. I found myself in that deserted movie set saloon, my role over, but still caught up in this feeling.
Well, here's to a fascinating profession.
Say tea. Well, the old Duke socked it to me again.